Just to show you how legitimate I am to talk about all these new technologies, here is my smartphone. Merci, Alvaro. So, yes, indeed, as Gunnar said, I will have a slightly different approach. At this stage in the conference, I think one thing is clear to me, that if there is an hold-up, it's an hold-up by experts in the SEP field. I'm completely lost in this. I've heard this many, many, many times. So let me offer you a kind of different perspective. And for this, I don't need your attention. I don't have slides. You can relax, sit in your seats quietly. You are just a few minutes away from coffee. I just need your imagination. So let's imagine. Let's say we are 5 years from now, and we are living in a connected world. And Brussels, believe it or not, is a smart city. So smart city, smart buildings, smart streets, smart tunnels. wait, even the commission is smart in this world. And everything, if you want to enter the street, you have to be connected. And we could well imagine a law making it mandatory for cars to be connected for safety reasons. Or your insurance company could ask you to have a connected car. Otherwise, you would have to pay a huge premium. And in this context, let's imagine now that the connected car you wanted to buy is blocked for sales in Belgium, or in Germany, or in Romania, or in Texas. Doesn't matter, but it's blocked for sales because for good or bad reasons, and here please watch my words, I'm not taking positions, for good or bad reasons, it failed to acquire its the IP rights connected to its, attached to its connectivity module. You can see the headlines. Car X or YMZ blocked for sales. From a marketing perspective, I believe that would be huge publicity for that car. From an IP perspective, from an IP policy, however, I think the publicity would not be that good. And that's exactly what we don't want to see. We want IP to be part of the solution, to facilitate the rollout of IoT, and not to be an obstacle. Okay, most probably this car will not be blocked for sales. What may well happen, though, is that all these connected devices, all these smart products we are all waiting for, well, all this may well be delayed because all the industry actors in the IoT world, they need predictability. And at this moment, in the SEP regime, they don't have it. So what can we do to bring them predictability for SEPs? Well, first thing, what we don't want to do. We don't want war. Let's leave behind us this smartphone war. Let's move to a collaborative environment because IoT is collaborative. And I would like to use this conference. You have invited speakers from different parts of the world. And let's also envisage common understanding at the international level of the general principles that can be applied. So if it's not a war, well, you can buy patent peace. This one, I don't like it at all. Well, first, buying peace in general, history tells us, is not a very good long-term solution. Then, why on earth would we bury IP problems, whereas I believe actually IoT is bringing an opportunity to clarify the rules, and everybody, all actors, should understand those rules. Okay, if you do not buy peace, you can buy time. That's easy. And I would argue here, over the last 5, 10, or 15 years, we have bought enough of this time. Time is over now. IoT, 5G is tomorrow. And actors need predictability now. They have to prepare their business plans. They cannot live in this mess. Orgy. What we don't want to be is an orgy. You know, you remember this. Gunnar is a fervent reader of The Economist. You remember this article in The Economist referring to SEPs as an orgy for lawyers. Well, here, please stop using your wild imagination, because there is high probability that the person sitting next to you is a lawyer. So you can fantasy about this orgy, but not here. IoT needs a better picture. We need to bring probability and predictability, and business actors don't need this orgy picture. So what we want for SEP regimes then? Three things, or three pillars: essentiality, enforcement, and valuation of technology. Essentiality first. Well, let's tackle this over-declaration problem. We all know the merits of over-declaration early on in the standardization process. But where do we end up now? We end up with a system with a very opaque picture of self-declared technology. And there is no filters. There is no scrutiny on what technology is actually essential here. So I would suggest a cascade of actions to fine-tune that list and bring more visibility. The first one, I believe we should give incentives to patent holders, to declarants, to clarify at different points in the process their technology and explain why and how their technology is relevant to the standard. As a second layer in this cascade, and I'm glad actually Serge referred to it, at the SSO level, there are all these engineers drawing technical specifications. Well, I believe they are well placed to make a technical assessment of those technologies and to see whether and how they are relevant to their standard. And if you don't want to call it an essentiality check, fine, let's make it a technical assessment. Third layer in this cascade, again with the idea to narrow down this huge list of declaration. Well, here I suggest this has already been discussed, and Jan mentioned that there is a lot of expertise out there. So let's introduce a third-party scrutiny. We can make use of the expertise of patent examiners, and this has been discussed, but if we manage to narrow down the list of declaration, then we have less patents to examine. Also, if we don't know how this works, let's have a pilot case and we see how this could work. So this cascade of filters should give a better picture and more predictability of what is actually essential. Again, because this IoT world, that's what they want, more predictability. Now let's move to enforcement. Well, IoT actors are not always familiar with licensing regime from the ICT sector. Plus, we can't expect them to go through this long and iterative process of litigation, testing the boundaries of the interpretation of Huawei. There must be a simpler way to do this. So I believe, again, there is an opportunity with the IoT to clarify rules for all the actors, to clarify the rules of engagement. Third point, after essentiality enforcement, the valuation of technology. That's the tricky question, but probably the most interesting one. And with IoT, the value chain are complex to analyze. The supply chain are also getting longer and with a lot of subcontractors. And the key question here is, of course, the distribution of the added value along that chain. Who will capture the value? Well, I believe there is ample room here to analyze the possible methodologies to value technologies. And we have to understand the impact those methodologies can have on the different actors, sector per sector, or we can have case studies again, but there is a lot of work here that we can do in the light of IoT. So all these three elements, essentiality, enforcement, and valuation of technology, I believe have to be addressed in an holistic approach. It's a bit like my car from the beginning. It has wheels, a motor, a connectivity module. Here, that's the same thing. You have to apprehend all this together, and you don't want a patchwork of disseminated actions. So, to conclude, what I just told you, IoT needs predictability. There are three elements to prepare this SEP regime: essentiality, enforcement, valuation of technology. So let's think outside the ICT SEP box, and let's bring predictability to the IoT. And hopefully we can enjoy Brussels being a smart city in 5 years. Merci.